So it's been a little while. It's been a couple weeks. Sorry about it. A few weeks ago, I just like caught up and everything, and it was Thursday at 7 before I knew it, and didn't have time to put together the stuff. So appreciate you guys understanding. Happy New Year, and I'm excited to do this. The last five, four or five chapters in the book. So this week was evaluation. Trying to think the answer. Here we go. So in the last few weeks in this section, we've talked about expressions, and Chris talked about quasi quotation. And just as a reminder, quasi quotation is quasi because of the ability not only to quote, to capture or capture the expressions, but also unquote. And some you could do that kind of selectively, meaning that you can unquote pieces of an expression to modify it, and that allows you to create templates and kind of combine a lot of pieces of expressions to make new expressions. And you can also do some neat things. I think Chris talked about this as well, where you can like unquote an arbitrarily long sequence of arguments with this unquote splice. It's kind of like this. When I read through it again, I was like thinking it was called bang, 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 but I think it's called, looking through the last chapter again and reviewing it, I think it's unquote splice is the proper way to refer to it. And so below is just an example of one of these, quasi quotation kind of processes from the last chapter. And so you have a certain variable that's a string, I think in this case, and it's passed by the user into this function called mean rm. Basically, it's a string that represents a variable that you want to get the mean of. And so you have to kind of capture it as a symbol by doing nsym. And when you're in a function, you need this nsym version, not just sym, if you're kind of dealing with something that the user has passed. And then you kind of have your typical mean function, but you're doing a bang bang operation here on the var symbol so that you can actually get the value that the user passed and unquote it. And then you have a new kind of mean function that has this variable as argument, and you're capturing that entire new function in this expression statement. And so I didn't have X in my environment, so I didn't comment this out. But basically, if you were to actually evaluate this, you would get using this mean rm function and a variable x, you would get two new functions that are expressions that have y and x as their arguments, because those are the two variables you've passed. So I guess in this case it's not right. So it's not a string. It's just a symbol that is already a symbol that you're capturing. Has anything else to add before I move on?
I'm sorry, I'm just trying to understand. So the nsym function is changing it from a character string to an object name, right?
I think actually in this case, so it's confusing because a lot of the examples I've used with in the recent, since we started talking about this, are with passing strings and then creating symbols out of those strings. But it looks like from the example down here that you're actually passing X that's supposed to be a symbol into this function already. And then I think nsym just like holds that symbol without evaluating it. And then that's what it looks like to me. But if anyone wants to jump in as well, you can.
Yeah, this is one of the areas that I have a lot of trouble debugging. But I've found that if you wanted to mock it up, I think we can use sim outside it. So you could say X is sim, like maybe you'll use it in like a mutate or something, or sorry, I'm trying to think. But sometimes I'll mock up with that. I'm just trying to think of like how you're using it here, how I would do it. But yeah, maybe in the, I think I'm usually like passing a data frame, doing some manipulation, and then like sending it on its way. I'm not doing a lot where I'm just like doing one function on an unquoted variable, but I'm always mocking up like a sim object to say like, well, this is the column I'm gonna pass it. So like I'll toy around with it using the MPG data set, and then I'll do like X is sim class. And so it creates it as a symbol object, and then I can actually run those two lines, and they'll come through. So I don't have to like finish the function, and I don't know, like I can like play around with it in the console. But I really get tripped up on like quo versus quoter versus nsim versus sim, like, and they all have s's as options as well. So sim versus sims, and
yeah,
I do feel like I'm just like throwing, you know, at the wall, seeing what sticks. I wish I had a better facility with it.
Yeah, so I just looked up the documentation for sim and nsim. And so for sim, it takes a string or a list of strings. And so in any of these, in almost all of these cases, the plural version is just taking like a list of whatever the base or the kind of typical version without, that's not plural, the singular version takes. And then let me just look at, let's see, expression. See, look at what the dot, dot, dots are. Okay, so for nsim, it's a name of argument to capture without evaluation. So I think in this case, I think nsim is actually, I think it's var is already a symbol that's just being like kind of frozen and like held without evaluating. So like, I think normally if you were to pass a symbol into a function and you didn't do this, it would try to evaluate it in the function context like right away. That's what I think normally happens. But again, I'm not an expert on this. And then, and I think with this, it doesn't do that. And it keeps that object or that symbol, and then evaluates it here within this mean context. So it unquotes it. So you actually get whatever that symbol represents. And then you're capturing that again as an expression within, you know, using the mean function that already exists. So I don't, maybe I just made things more confusing, but that's my understanding of that.
So I just tried this with a string and a symbol, and both of them work.
Oh, really?
I think nsim with a string or a symbol will work.
Okay.
Can I share my screen for a sec?
Yeah, go for it.
Or we could do it at the end.
No, you can do it right now.
Okay. Let's share screen. So yeah, I think what I was trying to describe is sometimes I'm trying to work like in the inside of a function, and I know I want to pass something without having to quote it. So I'll just kind of mock up it using sim. And then you can call it with bang bang or curly curly. I think it works for both.
Yeah, and that's how I've used it since we learned about it, is like all in my examples, I have like a, you know, list of variable names that are strings that I pass to like a map. And then I'm doing some kind of function that's like selecting different variables from the same data frame. And I'm selecting within a pipe sequence, like with select just as Jake has it, you know, a different variable depending on what you know, what string the map is on at any given time.
So could we write this out real quick? So sim is going to be like a string kind of,
string input and a symbol output, right?
String input, yeah, thank you. And then what is quo? Is that in your, are you going to get to it?
Oh yeah, I actually made a diagram that
I'll let you do that. But yeah,
sort this stuff out. I think it's similar to what you're doing here. Maybe we'll come back to it.
Sure. Yeah.
And then I think this stuff needs discussion. You know, you need to kind of ask questions and work your way through it and figure it out together. And you know, anyway, I think that's kind of the way to do it. But let's do a few. I don't go into like a ton of depth on the sections because there's a lot of stuff, but we'll have time to talk about it. So this week we're going to talk about fundamentals of evaluation, including a couple examples of source and local, tidy evaluation, so closures, data masks. I made a diagram to try to connect all these things, I think in a similar way that Jake was just doing. I'm hoping we can like modify it and rearrange things together, and that'll be a good kind of focus point for a discussion. And then I also have a problem in mind that if we want to do something else, whatever, we don't have to do, but something that I think can be solved by, I haven't figured it out yet, but I think it can be solved by some of the tools we're learning about this week. So I think the neat thing about this week is that it's kind of the mechanics of how the tidyverse and your ability to refer to columns in a data frame without without quoting them, you know, passing a quoted argument or anything like that. Like if you ever have coded in like a lot of other languages, like when I've done stuff in Python, for instance, a lot of the time you have to quote things like column names, right? And so this kind of data masking and closure and like tidy evaluation stuff is the reason why you're allowed to do these like things that make the code, I think, easier to read. So I think it's what makes R, I think, special in a lot of ways, is this kind of non-standard evaluation stuff. And I think, you know, if you've used tidyverse and all these verbs, you're interacting with it all the time. So it's kind of interesting to understand the details of. This is the diagram I made, but we don't have to go into details right now, but I just wanted to say that this is kind of my attempt to link these different data types and objects and functions with each other, and including closures and expressions but I think some of it might be a little bit off, so it'd be fun to talk about, but I want to go through a couple of these sections just as kind of overview first. So just the basics of evaluation, any kind of evaluation, you're talking about evaluation, you're always talking about an expression in an environment. And so in this case, right, the first example, you have X that's bound to the number 10, the integer 10, and when you evaluate it, it's evaluating the object X, and you're getting the value of X. In this case, the environment is just kind of implicit. It's your global environment. But if you want, you can also pass any other environment, or, you know, in this case, they're just saying an environment where X is 1,000. And so since Y is already defined in your global environment, after searching this environment, so it finds X in this environment you've passed, and it knows that X is 2, doesn't find Y there, it goes to your global environment and evaluates this expression X plus Y. And so that's just kind of the basics of evaluation, is that it takes an expression and an argument, or sorry, an expression and an environment to kind of be able to evaluate something. And so this is one, I guess, application that Hadley talks about with expressions and evaluation. There's a function called local, which I believe is a base function that allows you to, and in some ways this seems kind of like a, I don't know how connected it is to the stuff that's around it in terms of content, but it's a function that takes, a certain, so you're basically creating like a little mini environment within the function. So you're saying that I want X to be 10, Y to be 200, and then I want to do something with that stuff that I've just put in this local environment. And then once you've done it, if I tried to refer to X and Y, you wouldn't be able to find it unless it was unless it was in your global environment. So it kind of creates a little temporary, almost like I thought of like the function closure stuff that we learned about a while ago in a similar way, right? Like if you're doing some stuff inside a function, once that function completes, right, you can't refer to that stuff anymore unless you've outputted it to something that's in your global environment or like assigned it, done like a super assignment or something like that. But yeah, so it temporarily stores variables and evaluates the expression that's inside that function. Source is another one he talks about. So basically, source takes in a file that I think is a string. It parses it and then it evaluates it line by line and it returns the final result. And so he made a, for both of these examples, actually, he made his own kind of version of it that's a little bit simpler than the source code for the base functions, but just to show some of the concepts that we're learning about here. So in this case, you just have a file path. You're reading in that entire file line by line, and then you're collapsing it into one string separated by a new line break. And then you parse kind of all the expressions that are in this file. So you take out the string and you convert it to an expression using this parse expressions function. And then for each expression that you've parsed, they're evaluating, he's evaluating it in this environment, that whatever the environment is, that either the default is this caller environment or whatever environment you pass to this function. It evaluates each of those expressions individually, stores it in the result, but that just gets overridden each time as you move along this kind of caller environment here, which I think, someone correct me, but I believe this caller environment is just the environment in which this function is being called, right? So it'd just be everything that's happening within this function environment. So I guess if there's an expression here that like creates a variable within that caller environment in like a previous step in this process, it would know the value of that and be able to refer back to it, I would think. Anyway, and then so it does this and replaces results or res, you know, until this gets the last expression, and then it returns invisibly the results, so the final result.
I think you can think of it as appending to your environment in each iteration. It's going and like evaluating.
Oops, that. Sorry. There you go.
Yeah. So, so for each expression, yeah. Cause the environment is itself like an kind of its own object. And so you're kind of like filling the environment with the different evaluations. And then at the very end, you're returning all of those into the user's global environment, I think. So like within the script, it's like building it into that env object and kind of mm-hmm. it all. And then when it's done, res comes over to the global environment. I don't know if that's like
yeah
saying the same
yeah.
thing.
Yeah, I think so. I think that's what my understanding is too. So if you pass the caller, or you keep it as default and it's just the caller environment here, then it evaluates the expression each line, and then it's kind of storing that stuff in the caller environment. If in this case, if you were just keep that default, and then, but I don't think anything is happening or affecting your global environment until this result is returned at the end.
I think you're right.
Yeah. Cool. So again, I don't quite see the connection, to be honest. I mean, some of these functions he talks about in the surrounding sections, and you know, I guess it's interesting that you're kind of going from a string to an expression to evaluation, and maybe that's why he shared it. But anyway, yeah. Okay. So. So he goes over kind of the basics of evaluation, talks about these two applications, and then I thought a couple of these questions and exercises were interesting. So this first one, and for the second one, I actually have a kind of a different application of it from my own work that I wanted to share. So, but anyway, for this first one, he says, carefully read the documentation for source. What environment does it use by default? What if you supply local equals true, and how do you provide a custom environment? So did anyone get a chance to think about that, or
so I think I learned more than a month ago, so
right, because you prepared for the one that I was able to do. Okay, that makes sense. So I think what's happening with this is that the default for source, for source, let me just double check. Okay. So I think the default for source, I forget what I said originally. Hang with me a second there. Just rereading this part. I confused myself. All right, let's come back to that one. All right. So this one I thought was kind of interesting. So fill in the function bodies below to re-implement get and sim, get and assign functions using sim, expression, and evaluate. And so get is just a base function that basically evaluates like a symbol. So if you pass it like x, and x is has 3 assigned to it, then if you use get, it'll just return 3. And then you can, I think in the base get as well, I believe you can supply an environment. And then assign, I think a lot of us have used in the past, but basically you give it a string name and a value, and then it assigns that value to an object with that name that you passed it. And so he's asking us, can we do this same thing, the same functionality for get and assign, but with sim, expression, evaluate. So I tried to do that, first I'll just set up the example. I have sometimes at work, like I set up, and you guys probably have done this too, where you have some kind of a configuration or parameter file that you use to set up an analysis. And in this case, I'm using like let me have it somewhere. I thought I pasted it in. Anyway, like a YAML format file. So what that looks like is just, actually I have it in my RStudio. Let me just share it for a second. Okay, so it could be anything really, right? But in this case, it's just a special, like JSON, et cetera, like a different file format that you can use to store data. And in this case, I just call the section config. I have some kind of a value within a kind of a sub value within that called day, or I guess name called day, and then a value for day called Thursday, and then start and end. And this is just a simple example, but that's something that, you know, you could potentially read in to an analysis at the beginning of your script. And what I was originally doing in this at work was I was would read in the whole file and then pull out the different pieces of it, and using Pluck, which I learned from Jake in this book club, Jake's presentation. But I would actually take each one and manually assign it. So I would say Pluck start from this file, and assign it to an object called start. You know, Pluck end from this file, assign it to an object called end. And this is just what that file looks like. So you have, it's the way that read YAML works is it reads it as a named list.
Kevin, could you reshare your presentation?
Oh my God, I didn't reshare this part. Okay, thank you. All right, there we go. So what I would normally do is, and what I've been doing in one of these scripts that I use this is like I had been assigning every component of this YAML file as a separate variable line by line. And I took a look at that and I was like, well, it doesn't seem too super elegant, you know, because I'm repeating a bunch of stuff here. And so I think this example with these two, the assign function can help with that. So this is what I ended up doing for assign. So basically you're taking a name, a value, and an environment. And I think I cheated a little bit because he didn't say anything about bang bang, but maybe you all can help with doing something about that. But anyway, so this name, in this case, so this name is a string. And it'd probably be easier if I actually showed the example so that you can see a real, oh, maybe it's the next one. I have my slides, sorry. Oh. Okay, well, and I'm rough after the new year. All right. So you have a string that's some kind of a name of an object that you want to create, and you have a value that you want to assign to that object as a value. And so this function captures that string as a symbol. So now it's a special symbol object. And then within this expression call, it's doing an unquoting. So you're actually getting not the argument name, so you're not getting the word name, but you're actually getting the string that is passed, that's assigned to, or you know, that you're using in that argument the user is inputting. And then you're doing the same for value, so you're getting the actual value of value and not just the word value. And then you're capturing all of that in your global environment as an expression, and then you're evaluating it. So let me just do that really quick in my RStudio just to show you one, just a simple example. All right. Hey, see this? All right. So like if I wanted to assign a variable called Kevin and give Kevin a value of 1989 when I was born. And then I want to, well, there's already the global environment. I guess I already passed, modified so that it's have to pass something, global environment. And so right now I don't have a variable named Kevin my environment. And so I do that and now I have a variable named Kevin here. And with my birth year listed. So it works, but it uses this bang bang operator, and he didn't really list that in an example. So maybe it's not, you know, cheating, or I'm doing something that isn't what he expected, but yeah. And then, so, you can kind of extend this. I thought I had it already teed up where you could, let's see here. Oh yeah. I thought I already had it read in. Sorry, nothing's working out for me tonight. If I actually had the file in my directory, in this case, I'm actually going through that named list, and for each name in that list, taking the name as the variable name and the value in that list entry as the value, doing that assign function, and then it's all going to be in my global environment. And so instead of going through and plucking each named list item and their value and doing a manual assign line by line, this allows you to do this for any length file, and it builds your working environment with like two lines of code. So anyway, I think it's like kind of interesting.
Nice.
Anyone have any ideas for how to do this without bang bang? Or it's kind of hard to like reason about this stuff without trying it out and like having it on your local machine, but I don't know. Anyone have any thoughts about it?
I think it makes sense, given what we were talking about earlier. So like get would have, you know, not returned Kevin, but would have gone and looked for Kevin, right? And then.
Yeah, I actually did. I realized I didn't do the get part. Here we go. This should work. Oh, there we go. Okay, let's see if it. I think it'll actually go now. There we go. All right. Oof. So now you should see. Even if I remove these, right, you would have day, and start all populating in the environment. And so for me, it worked. The nice thing is that a lot of other people who don't use it are familiar with the YAML format, so they can just create this config file or like you put in information, send it to me, and then I can run the script by reading in this YAML, populating the environment, you know, et cetera, to kind of generalize it to other cases and different parameters.
It's pretty slick. I like it.
Thanks. Cool.
I have a question.
Yes.
Why are you using sim, not nsim?
Let's see. Let me go back to it. Here.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's a good question because it seems like in all the cases in the book where there's a argument that's passed to a function that some of the user is supplying, they always use like the n version of all these functions. So I take your question and I don't know the answer to it. Let me see if you do that, if it changes anything.
Yeah, I tried to replicate your code here and they seem to work the same when you use strings as your first input, but if you use a symbol as your first input, nsim will work and sim will throw an error.
Interesting. So if I said my argument, Kevin, and I did sim. So this is what you're saying, like if I did this.
I don't see any typing, so.
Oh, maybe it's a little delayed.
Oh yeah, there we go.
Okay. So I think I passed it a symbol, right? My argument is a symbol.
With no quotes on it, in assigned to is what I did.
Yeah. Huh. Maybe because it already exists. Let me try do Chris or something. All right. Huh. I don't know. It creates a new variable here for me. Do you want to share your screen?
If you do, if you do git around that though, git my argument, it should do what you want.
But this still, like, this is, I'm saying this isn't throwing an error, right? But like, you mean like this, should give the same thing, right? Okay, huh. But before, when I didn't have get though.
Sorry. Yeah, I guess in 180. Because it's making, in your environment, it's making my argument equals Chris. Or no, sorry. I got that wrong. Never mind.
I was just thinking if you don't quote Chris in your assigned to, that's going to throw an error.
Yeah. Oh, I see.
Yeah.
So if you want to pass it a symbol, you don't want that symbol to be evaluated.
Yeah. I think that throws an error.
Yeah. Yeah. Only strings can be converted to symbols.
And like if I pass nsim with nsim, I think it will actually still create Chris.
There. Yeah. Okay. Cool. That's nice. Yeah. Yeah, and that's actually a better way to do it also because it's more consistent with the tidyverse and the rest of R, right, where you're not passing a quoted argument most of the time.
No, I'm a little stuck on why it works for both. I mean, I followed along mostly, but is that just because assign would allow you to do it either way?
I just don't know if nsim has like has different accepted inputs than sim does.
Mm-hmm. Wait, let me do like just another one that doesn't exist. Huh. Hey, so I guess that makes sense. Right. I mean, like what you just said has to be true, right? That sim takes a string as an argument and nsim can take a symbol or a string. And in this case, it's taking the symbol, but it doesn't evaluate it yet because it kind of freezes it in this nsim call. And then since it's being assigned in this expression, it just knows what to do with it because it's giving it a value. It doesn't have to find it in the environment because it's assigning a value to it. And it's like always a symbol throughout
the whole thing. So it continues being a symbol.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
You're just like moving this symbol around without actually evaluating it. Up only at the end are you evaluating it, asking R to evaluate it. Yeah.
In your diagram, you'd have like a self-referential loop with nsim mm-hmm. on a sim, I think is.
We can, yeah, let's, okay. Yeah. I'm excited to go to that diagram because I think you guys will, we should do stuff like that. Or maybe it'll just get so unreadable that it won't be worthwhile anymore, but it's worth a try. All right, cool. I'm going to go on to the next slide just to get through the kind of overview part. Okay. All right. So a closure is the next kind of big thing he talks about. And a closure, it describes as an object that contains both an expression and an environment. So in this case, this is just a super simple example, you have a function x that takes some kind of an expression as an argument, and you're turning that into a closure. And so in this case, just like nsim, like we were just seeing a second ago, most of the time when you're dealing with arguments that a user has passed into a function, you see n in front of the action of the function that you're doing. there is a like a version of this that's just quo that's outside of that you call outside of the function context. But anyway, so it kind of captures that expression as well as the environment that expression, I guess, is from or was created in. That's the right way to say it. And so in this case, and you can also specify that environment that that the expression is tied to in the closure. So in this case, you just are passing A plus B, and you have A plus B as your expression. And so the closure has this expression attribute or element and an environment. In this case, it's the global environment, which I guess is the default here if you since you haven't passed any other environment argument here to end quote. And so you can create closures. So like I said a second ago, when we're in the function context, you have N in front of this quo, but since we're not here, it's just quo. And so here you're passing this expression X plus Y plus Z. And you aren't evaluating or anything, you're just kind of capturing it in this closure. And then you have a closure with the expression element and environment element, just like before. If you want to specify the environment that the closure should be kind of associated with, you need this new closure function. So I guess what I said a second ago wasn't right. So you, with quo, you just pass an expression to it. But with quote new closure, you can pass the expression and an environment. And so in this case, we're passing the expression X plus Y and the environment that has X equals 1 and Y equals 10 in it. And I guess this is just the memory address for that environment. And somehow my next header bled onto this page. Okay. And it doesn't go any further. I think I forgot a break here. Sorry, one second. I have more stuff here. Yeah, I forgot the break. Did it stop sharing? It did. Okay. Oops. I forgot breaks, so let me just add them for the rest. All right, we should be good to go. Okay. So we did talk about creating closures. Okay, so then if you want to evaluate a closure, you can call eval tidy. And so it will evaluate the expression that's in the closure and then kind of listen to the environment that you've specified. So in this case, X equals 1, Y equals 10, and that'll be like the first place it'll look. And in this case, it's just adding X plus Y, so it becomes 11. And then another element to closures is a data mask. And so this is what makes kind of a lot of the tidyverse stuff work kind of seamlessly. So basically what a data mask is a data frame where the code will look first for expressions. And so if you have a data frame where y equals the sequence from 1 to 10, and you've defined a closure that has an expression x times y, an environment of x equals 100, and you evaluate it using eval tidy. So this is the closure you're evaluating, and you also pass it this data mask. So then it'll go to evaluate X times Y And for X, it'll look in the environment you passed in the closure, and it'll say, okay, X is 100. And then since Y is a column in the data frame that you've kind of inserted here as a data mask, it'll know to look there next and just multiply this, you know, vector by the value for X here, which is 100. And so I guess the way I've been thinking since reading this, thinking about closures, is that it's kind of just a really kind of specific or like helpful way to construct the environments in which you're evaluating expressions. In this case, it allows you to refer to columns in the data frame without having to, or in a lot of cases, we're using select and filter and all those tidyverse functions without actually having to quote those arguments. I think the diagram, I should move the diagram because I think it brings a lot of this together. This is almost on the second to last slide. So then data mask pronouns. So with data masks, when you're kind of evaluating something that's in a data mask, you don't quite know just from the code where the value came from that was evaluated. So it could have been in the closure environment. It could have been in the data mask part of the environment, or it could have been in like your global environment. And it's not always clear, like if you're referring to a symbol, for instance, where it is. And so with data masks, they kind of tidy evaluation has these two pronouns, so dot data and dot environment, where you can actually refer to those two components of the closure specifically, so you reduce that ambiguity. So if you wanted to evaluate DF here only using the data component of the closure, right, you would refer to it by dot data and then $X, so you kind of index it like you would a data frame, and then again here they're referring to the environment, and so you get two different results here because X in the environment is one, but in the data frame it's two, and so you can kind of evaluate whatever expression you want to evaluate in those two kind of subcomponents of the closure, I guess.
And Kevin, if X in the data frame were a column, so I guess a vector, would it return a vector?
That's a good question. Let's think about it for a second.
It 2 is a vector, so it's a vector with one value.
Right. Let me just bring this to R Studio for a second and just see if I do this here. All right, let me just reshare so I get back into my computer here. All right, so I think width is the same thing as width 2. It's just width 2 is the version that he had defined in the book. So it takes, so you have df and then dot data x here. See if I'm not falling in the same way. Data and expression. Maybe it's the other way around in this one. There we go. Maybe not. So anyone see what I'm potentially doing wrong here? Or... Sure. Let me see if I could pull up their his width code for a second.
I've used width differently, so I'm not quite able to troubleshoot on that one.
That's all right. I think I just found the function he used. All right, let's see if we can reproduce this. So width 2, so passes df and x, df and dot data x. Okay. Okay, so we reproduce what they have in the book. So it's quoting the expression and then evaluating it, doing a tidy evaluation of that expression with data as the data mask. Okay. So you're asking if you pass, so if X in this case in the data frame is like a vector, so, or I'll just say sequence. Or whatever, 1 to 10. And if you did data, so you're referring to the data mask, is it right to say that this is a closure, I think, right? So it gives you the entire, yeah. So I guess the expression is this, in this case, is x in both cases. And in one, the value of x is 1. In the data frame, the value of x is this numeric vector from 1 to 10, or whatever that vector is.
So presumably x can have different classes in the two environments.
So if it was... I need to make this a vector, sorry. Data, yep. So whatever the environment is, I guess that it's looking into, whether it's looking particularly like right at the data mask or in the global environment, whatever X is, it'll evaluate to.
Great, thank
cool.
you.
Cool, yeah, that was good. Thanks. All right, so let me go to the next one. All right. Okay, so like I was saying before, the neat thing I think about the data mask topic and closures and tidy evaluation is that it kind of gives you some insight into how select and all these kind of tidy verse functions work when you have a data frame. So he, in the book, he kind of created his own version of a lot of these functions that are a little bit simpler than the real version, but just to see the application of these concepts. So in this case, I guess you have a data frame. So just like, you know, any tidy verse function, it'll take the data frame as the first argument. And then some, you know, unknown length of extra arguments that I think in this case is some kind of, yeah, so it's some kind of an expression. And so he's like, you know, building up a function that just does the same thing as select. So, you know, looks at a data frame and selects columns B through D. And so the first thing that he's doing here is that he's taking these extra arguments here, which is an expression, B through D in this first example, is capturing it creating a closure out of that argument or that expression. So again, since it's in a function, it's and it could be any number of arguments. So it's like the plural version. Okay, so then you have those capture that whole expression captured as a closure. And then let's see here. So you're getting the column names from the data, and you're creating a sequence, a numeric sequence from one until the length of the number of columns in your data frame. So this is just allowing you to do this kind of indexing here. Since it passes letters, you need to kind of somehow convert that into a numeric sequence in order to index kind of in a base R fashion, which is the underlying code here. And then so it just makes it a named list with I think the first argument is the vector and the second argument is the names. And so it's a named list from, let's say, 1 to 10 with the names being the names of the data frame. And then this is, didn't talk through this part. Hopefully you're not cringing at my pauses here. So then you have this closure and a named list of variables, and you are saying, I want to map through each argument, right, or each expression in this dot closure, using the function eval_tidy. And each time I want to evaluate it in this environment that has vars in it. So it has all the names of the variables and their index. I need to think for a second how that's pulling out the matching, columns that you've selected.
It returns numbers, right?
Yes. So it returns the index that matches for the, so it's evaluating the expression with numbers instead of like B through D. So it's evaluating, let's say, like 2 to 3 for that environment where the data frame is that you've, included in the closure.
So is that what dots? So when you're passing dots, I assume you're naming the columns you want.
Yeah. Well, it's an expression. It's any expression or columns. Yeah. So it could be one column. It could be this. B through D sequence. Yeah, it could be any expression that allows you to select or unselect certain columns.
Like, we're evaluating the names from B through D from vars, right? That's what the data mask is providing us with. So they're in the local environment, all those variable mm-hmm. names. And then it's saying, mm-hmm. like, so B is 2 in this case, maybe, you know? And so it says, okay, I know B is 2, so give me 2. And I knew that D is 4, so give me 4. And then evaluate that, like that full expression is evaluated to be 2 through 4.
Mm. Yeah, and so unlist is turning it into a vector, and then you've got the base R data subset with calls.
And it's just selecting those columns that in a numeric form, whatever the index is. Man, this stuff is not easy to work through. doing my best, but
you're doing good.
I mean, really, I'm trying to wrap my head around this stuff too. It's pretty daunting.
Yeah, I think I need to read through it like 20 more times. Cool. Well, thanks for y'all chiming in there. Okay, now we can go to the diagram, and I feel like it'll hopefully things will like. Light bulbs will go off maybe, but if not, that's okay too. Let me just...
Do you want me to do the Charlie thing from It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia?
What's that? I actually haven't seen that. Oh, sad. Sad, I know.
All over with the arrows pointing all over the place. And
okay. I think this makes sense once I kind of walk through it. So what I wanted to do is just basically like I was having trouble wrapping my head around all the different functions that are used here to capture symbols, to quote, to unquote, to evaluate. I was confused about the difference between unquoting and evaluating. So I was just like, I wanted to create something that brought it all together. And so I'll start like, I guess at the top of this. Let's say you just have a string. So like before we were trying to create an object out of the string Kevin, right? We were assigning it to 1989. If it's outside of a function, you can turn that into an expression or a symbol using sim. So just wrapping that string in sim. If you wanted to turn it into, and maybe this should be symbol here. If you wanted to turn it into a quoted expression, see, maybe this link is wrong here. Anyway, I'll just talk through it. If you wanted to turn it into a quoted expression, you can use parse. And so like, for instance, or like you can say parse text equals Kevin, and then that will now be a quoted expression. Or like if you wanted to say list x equals 10, right, then you could parse that string as an expression. And then if you have your some kind of an expression, or even like if you just have code that you are trying to modify in some way, you can capture that code using an expression, or you can kind of selectively evaluate pieces of it or substitute in like, you know, a different variable name or different argument or something that we saw before using bang bang or unquote splice if it's a list of expressions. And then kind of in, I added this here, but I don't think it ever really exists in like a permanent way, but after you've done that and before you've evaluated the expression part, you have this unquoted expression. And so you've gotten the value of the thing that you're kind of done bang bang on. And then that thing that's been evaluated now gets turned into an expression that's modified in some way. And so you can modify an expression. So this is just showing you can modify an expression that you've captured either through some kind of like list operation. And so, I think Jake, you were talking about this, or maybe we were just talking about it, where you have like, you had an example, or I think it was in the Slack, where you had an example where you've captured an expression, and it's just kind of like a list of symbols and language and all the different mm-hmm. kind of pieces of the expression, right? And then if you want to modify that, you just do some kind of list operation on it, right? Yeah. And then you get a modified expression. And then at the end, like everything kind of culminates in usually in you evaluating the expression you have. And so you can either, you know, once you have a quoted expression, you can evaluate it, you know, through a few different paths. And so, and then the lower part of this, right? So from string or like a file, you can use source, and that source will actually take that string or that file all the way from that raw format. It'll parse it as an as a bunch of a list of expressions or a bunch of expressions, and then evaluate and return to you the final result. And so that's why I just had this arrow going all the way from this raw string character all the way or file all the way to an evaluated expression. And then and I'll just finish this overview and then we can chat about it. But then a closure is, you know, it's bringing together an expression in an environment. And so we talked about new closure. And so if you want to kind of explicitly do that with a kind of a custom environment or supply an argument as an or environment as an argument, right, you need to use this new closure function. And so you have some kind of expression. You're passing it to new closure, you're passing an environment to it, and it gives you a closure. On the other hand, if you want just to take an expression and make it into a closure, you can use nquo or quo or any of those variants, right? Or nquos. I'm just going to leave it as quo because it's consistent with the rest of this. And then from the closure object, you can use evaltidy to evaluate it using some kind of a data mask, and that data mask has a dot data pronoun that you can refer to an environment pronoun, or you can just evaluate the closure directly without a data mask, and that gives you your evaluated function. And I just put a note up here, most of these functions have plural variations for list input and n variations for operating inside functions. And so, I don't know. So now we can draw like loops and mess it up and do whatever we want to do. But I don't know, it was helpful for me to just try to explain my way through this and just try to connect these pieces. But do you all think it makes sense, or is it more confusing than anything?
Well, beyond me, but I think it's a really useful visual.
Cool. That's good. Anyone else?
Yeah, the only part that gets mentally muddy for me is when you go from expression to quoted expression to modified expression.
Yeah.
That was like, the rest of it totally makes sense. And I like the flow from kind of top left to bottom right is how you would actually enact it, you know?
Yeah, so it's confusing because like, I wanted to include bang bang somehow and like these unquoting function, but those only really are used from what I've seen like inside a function which is inside like an expression call. But maybe you can use it outside of that context. I don't know. Cool. Do you know what I mean though? Like if you have like something like if maybe it's not the best thing to do this in Google Draw, but like if you had, let's say it had x equals 2, this is so weird doing this here, and then if I said, let's see, expression x plus y, and I wanted that x to actually be 2 in the expression instead of y, I would do that. So like, before, like, so that's what I was trying to capture is like you have this bang bang that unquotes this, but like it's not really like a state because it's, it doesn't stop here. It just like it passes that to the expression call and then it creates an expression with 2 plus y. But that's kind of what I was trying to capture there. I don't know. But I think there are also
down like this.
Sorry,
it's helpful to write them all down like this.
Yeah, cool. Yeah, I thought it, I just like I was like so there's just so many different terms and you know variables and or sorry functions. It's hard to wrap my head around. So, but I think there are also cases though, like in the context of of like a data frame or something, right? Like Jake, where you were saying before, and I've done this too, where you have, if you have like a symbol, car or something, right? Mm-hmm. Like there, so I think it's always used in the context of like inside of a function is my understanding.
I think John had a good like mnemonic for it. So he's, you could think of it as like not, right? So you could say like it's not car, but it's also not car, you know? So it's like, I want you to go find the object. The object's not actually over there, but it is available. But I don't know. I thought it was a funny way to think about it.
Because
you're like giving it something that's usually unquoted, right? So, you know, you said like go find X. Usually go find X would mean go look at my global environment. But instead it's like, well, actually I want you to work inside this environment and find X. But I thought, yeah, not was like a interesting way to think about it. And then the triple bang, he said, you know, if you turn it on its side, it's a little list. And so that helps you remember that for lists. So I thought that was a good way to think about both of those.
Cool. Yeah, that's helpful. I wonder, so if like you had a list of symbols for like it was like this, and then the next one was like symbol call to or whatever. Like, I don't know, maybe I should go actually into R and do that. But
I remember where we used that at work somewhere. One of our functions where we're like trying to read one of the parameters takes multiple inputs. And that is all unquoted. I have to look and think about that. But
Yeah, I think this needs to be in a function. I think what I've gotten confused before since we started introduced to these operators, and like I've tried to use it outside of a function, like to evaluate a symbol outside of like how, like just kind of in raw code or, you know, a bare line, and it throws an error, and I'm always confused why, because I'm like, but I just did that same thing in like a select or a mutate statement and like it was fine. But I know that now we know that there's kind of this data mask happening and, you know, like tidy evaluation, like it makes sense that it's different, but it seems to me that this is really only like works to do some kind of a modification within a function context, but could be wrong.
And I think the bang bang can be replaced with curly curly now. I think that's what they are suggesting.
Within the Magadar like data frame context.
I don't know if you can call it outside of like the tidy select.
I'm going to make this a different.
You can use curly curly, but not bang bang.
Okay.
Yeah.
I made this a different color just to reflect that it's like not as the same as the other everything else here. Josh, what were you saying before about the self-referencing loop?
Oh, just that if you were to run like sim on what you have as an expression, I think like in the case that an expression is a symbol, then it would become a symbol again. But like if you run expression on an expression that, if you run symbol on an expression that is not a symbol, I wonder what happens. It doesn't sound like it would.
Oh. And then you, are you storing it in another object? Or are you, because like, I guess in R, it's confusing because in R, like it's interactive. So if you just leave it bare, it'll automatically evaluate it. Right. But if you, like, hold on, let me just get into R for a second. So like you're saying if you tried to capture a string that's not actually a symbol. Like if I did that and then actually just stored it somewhere, I don't think there would be a problem. It's just like when you go to evaluate it, then there's a problem because it doesn't have that anywhere. Mm-hmm. But what were you saying? So is that what you're saying or?
No, I was saying if you were doing like, if you did
a sim of a sim or.
Yeah, if you do sim on sim, it will probably be fine.
Well, but I think it'll evaluate it in like a nested fashion. Right. Well, let's see. Yeah. So there's that example in the book. Let me just go to, I'm just going to copy it in. That was in exercises, I believe.
Well, I think what I was saying is like, if you had like sim of expression of X, it's going to give you back X. But if you had sim of expression of X plus Y, it's not going to work because it can't construe it as a string. Right.
So sim of expression plus y, like that?
Yeah, that shouldn't work.
Just think about it for a second. Right, because sim just takes string as an argument, right? Yeah, only strings can be converted to symbols. But this was the example in that exercise. So he was like, predict what each of these is going to be. It kind of evaluates it, I think, from the inner out. And if it has an evaluate at the end, you'll get 4. And if it has expression at the end, you'll get this whole expression, this whole chain here. So that gives you 4, that gives you 4, and that gives you an entire chain captured. So like, because if I try to do this here, it won't do anything. But if I did that, it works. Is there like a help page for Bang Bang? If I do, oh, it's a single object.
Can you scroll a little bit? Is it in R-Lang? Or is it in dplyr?
R-Lang.
Yeah.
So it takes an expression. See, I don't understand why that, like, this doesn't work. You know, or it doesn't have to be this whole thing, but like, why it doesn't like this as an argument for Bang Bang. Expression to be quasi-quoted. Oh, because it's already quoted. Now it's just do something weird. I have no idea how it did
that. And what does diffused mean? That's the highlighted.
Where? Where? Underline.
It's like right under the underline.
When a function takes multiple named arguments, and let's say, for example, mutate, is difficult to supply a variable as a name. So if the left-hand side of equals is diffused, giving the name of a variable results in the argument having the name of the variable rather than the name stored in that value. Okay, so let's look what that is.
I know what all of those words mean, but I have no idea what that sentence means.
I think it's like not a value. Is it not evaluated until? Because it says diffusing operators expression and enquo, so that's either capturing as an expression or capturing as a closure prevent the evaluation of R code.
I guess they just don't, like, you've got bare unquoted I don't know. There's like all these words that sound almost the same. Or it seemed like they'd be close together in a thesaurus.
Yeah. Where do you see bear? Sorry.
Just like as I'm looking on help pages, trying to answer my problems, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I think I just have to read this chapter a couple more times.
Results in the argument having the name of the variable rather than the name stored in that value. I mean, I get what the purpose is of that paragraph. I'm not sure I understand that the specifics of that sentence, but I guess I'm glad I read it though, because I guess it makes sense now, right? That like normally the left side of the equal sign doesn't get evaluated. It just, the object becomes the thing that's on the left side. Right. Okay. But like when you're in a context where you actually want the value that's in that object to be the object or the name of the object, at the end of this operation, when it's completed, you need something extra to tell it to evaluate it, to assign it to the name, the value rather than the name, rather than the object that the value is stored in. So like the nature of an equals function is that the stuff on the left side in R doesn't get evaluated. It just like whatever the name of that thing is, it just gets the stuff on the right side gets assigned to it. So I guess it's just like how equals primitive works, or yeah, so normally name would just become the thing that one is assigned to, because that's how equals works, but you want Jane to be the object that 1 + 2 is assigned to, so you need this bang bang to tell it to retrieve the value of name and assign this to it rather than name itself.
I know that I was trying to use Bang Bang in one of my packages. There's like an interesting thread on Slack. It was getting kind of buggy.
Oh, and here's your double braces that you're talking about in the new R-lang, right?
Mm-hmm.
That this replaces Bang Bang, and you can basically use it like glue.
It's so nice. So you need that, and then I guess they're calling it the walrus operator. So yeah. Yeah, I'm a fan. I do have to run, but thank you so much for...
Oh, wow, it's already 9:00.
Helping us understand.
I hope I did. it's exciting when you see like the select stuff and the filter and mutate and all that, because it's like the R magic kind of finally revealed, and everything that we've been building up to makes more sense now, I think. But it's pretty complex, so I think the next week is going to be good to look at like kind of applications of this with translation, with SQL and dbplyr and HTML as well, I think, right? Yeah. Cool. Thanks for this discussion. I thought this was fun. Maybe I'll post the link to that diagram so that if anyone wants to like modify it or take a swing at doing one or, you know, adding to it or whatever, you can do that. But do you think it was helpful to see that diagram or to talk through it?
Yeah.
Okay.
In order to understand this stuff, I'm going to end up probably consulting your diagram again.
I want some other folks in the thread too to take a look just to see if there's anything that's terribly wrong with it. But I don't know, as we talk through it, it seemed to make sense mostly, but except for this bang bang stuff. Anyway, awesome. Well, it's super late, so thanks again. Does anyone off, like right now, think they want to present next week? We can also continue in the thread.
I was going to say, I haven't presented in a while. I don't feel comfortable presenting next week's on translation because I don't know other languages, but the following chapter is on debugging and I can do that one.
Okay, great. All right, thank you. So looks like it's just a really short introduction on that one for this last section. For techniques, and then yeah, and then goes right into debugging. Okay, that sounds good. Thanks, Mike. Anyone else interested? There's only five of us here, but
Are the others temporarily away, or have they checked out?
It's kind of in and out. I know, like I think Chris says he can't attend the rest of them, and I'm not sure about others. Yeah,
Eric's been here in and out on a few of them and a couple other people.
I haven't seen Abby in a while. I assume she's
yeah. She dropped off there.
I'd say like, yeah, halfway through or something. But
Yeah, I'll do next week if no one else can, because I've already read most of the material for this section, so it's not too wild. Yeah, so I'll do it. It's fine.
Okay, thanks. Awesome. Well, I'm looking forward to that. That'll be fun to talk about more applications of this.
Cool. Jorge said he could do next week. Jorge, would you prefer to do next week?
Oh, his mic isn't working. Oh, he said, yeah. Okay.
Okay, cool. You can do it.
Okay. Thanks, Jorge. All right. So we have presenters for the next 2 weeks. Awesome. Well, I hope you guys have a good weekend. So chat soon.
Thanks very much, Kevin.
Yeah, thanks. Kevin, thank you. Some tough stuff, so thanks a lot for
us. I was sweating a little bit, but thanks for sticking out with me.
Yeah, you did great. Thank
this
you.
Is all volunteer work. We appreciate your effort.
Thanks. All right.
Good night.
All right, have a good night. Bye.